Pantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Lion of Judah, How Jesus Completes Biblical Judaism and Why Judaism and Christianity Separated, by Rabbi Kirt A. Schneider, narrated by Barry Abrams. Introduction. The Lord is one, so what happened to His people? I spent the first 10 years of my life in Beechwood, Ohio, a suburb of Cleveland with the second highest concentration of Jewish people outside Israel. 90% of Beechwood's residents are Jewish, so seeing a Gentile in our community was rare. In fact, everywhere you turned, you could find evidence of just how Jewish the environment was. Almost all the families in my neighborhood had names such as Rosenthal, Levine, Katz, Feinberg, Schwartz, Berg, and Stein. Most children my age attended Hebrew school 3 days a week after regular school had ended. Public schools closed on Rosh Hashanah, the Jewish New Year, and Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement. And on those days, it seemed as if the whole community was in temple. Although my family moved to Pepper Pike, another Cleveland suburb, when I was in the 6th grade, I continued attending Hebrew school. My family remained heavily involved with the Jewish community. I attended synagogue not only for Hebrew school, but also every year on Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur. In the 7th grade, I was bar mitzvahed in a conservative synagogue, and by that time it was clear to me that I was to be proud of my heritage. I remember getting this sense particularly during services in temple, when the rabbi would pray the Shema, the ancient prayer found in Deuteronomy chapter 6 that has become the centerpiece of Jewish belief and declaration. The Shema begins with, Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 4, the complete Jewish Bible. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God. The Lord is one. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 4. The problem, however, was that God wasn't really part of the picture, nor did He seem to be intimately ours. Although we were called God's chosen people, no one around me ever actually talked about Him, much less referred to Him in a personal way. The people I knew referred to Him as Adonai, the Hebrew word meaning Lord, but they never actually discussed who He was. Through all my early years, I never heard anything about knowing God or having a relationship with Him. A personal God was far removed from my experience in Beechwood and Pepper Pike. He was somewhere out there. At one point in history, He had interacted with my ancestors, but that was long, long ago. So far back that any stories about Him felt more like fairy tales than actual accounts. When I began attending Hebrew school at Park Synagogue, one of Cleveland's largest conservative synagogues, I again heard the Shema and its other parts, including V'yahavta et Adonai Elohecha b'chol levavcha u'v'chol nafshecha u'v'chol me'odecha, and you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5. As moving as these words sound, they were almost meaningless to me since I still knew nothing about God's love for me or His desire to be involved in my life. My mother drove me 3 days a week from regular school to Hebrew school, where I learned how to read and write Hebrew. There, I memorized Hebrew prayers and was taught about my Jewish heritage, culture, and customs. I absolutely dreaded it. In fact, I became so bored with Hebrew school that I often feigned walking into the school building and, after my mother drove off, went across the parking lot to sit under a tree in a secluded wooded area. My playing hooky eventually cost me, and I spent that summer with a private tutor while all my friends were out having fun. Yet even in this one-on-one setting where I was to learn about what it meant to be Jewish, part of a people formed out of a covenant with God, I don't remember even once my teacher telling me about a God whom I could be close with or who loved me. Indeed, most of my religious instruction centered exclusively on preparation for my bar mitzvah. This would be the pinnacle of my Jewishness, when at age 13, I was to become a son of the commandment, the literal translation of bar mitzvah. In transitioning from boyhood to manhood, I was to be held morally responsible before God and obey His commandments, mitzvot. But what kind of God was this? I prepared for my bar mitzvah by memorizing the part of the Torah reading assigned to me for that day. My parents hired a tutor to help me with this, and I listened endlessly to an audio recording of my part. Yet, as the big event neared, the words of the Hebrew Bible still never sank in, but were simply words I needed to mouth to pass the test. I was participating in our Jewish culture, but remained unmoved in a practical, spiritual sense. End of the road. My bar mitzvah lived up to its hype. When the day finally arrived, I was both excited and nervous. I had studied countless hours and worked hard on what I would do in the ceremony, yet I just wanted to get through it so I could have fun. During my bar mitzvah, I recited some Hebrew prayers, read my portion of the Torah and the Hebrew prophets, listened to the rabbi, and received my tefillin, two small boxes containing portions of the Torah that are tied to the hand, arm, and forehead. I will never forget the sense of accomplishment once everything was done, yet what I remember most was the party afterward. This was no ordinary party. It took place at a beautiful banquet facility called the Executive Club. The celebration was so grand, my parents hired two separate bands for the music, one for the adults and another for the children. Out of the hundreds of family members, classmates, and friends who came, I was particularly interested in a girl named Janice, whom I especially liked. As the band was playing, I made my big move and asked Janice to dance with me. What a sight it must have been to see my adolescent 5-foot frame moving out of step with her 5-foot-7 body in an awkward, slow dance. Standing so close to her, I was, I thought, in love. It was a day I will never forget, yet it officially ended my Jewish education. I still wasn't sure why my bloodline defined so much in my life and set me apart in so many ways. Sadly, most Jewish people I know share a similar story. Our formal Jewish education concludes when the bar mitzvah party is over, and we are left with far more questions than answers about God, life, our Jewish identity, and everything in between. Though the deeper inquiries linger as we age, what makes us so special? What role do we play in the world? Why are we hated so much? They often get buried under our customs, traditions, history, and expectations. For many Jews, these cultural elements become the essence of what it means to be Jewish rather than anything related to the God who made us Jewish in the first place. We get bar mitzvahed, or bat mitzvahed for girls, and celebrate Passover, Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, Hanukkah, and perhaps a few other Jewish holidays, but we often don't understand what these actually mean or why we do them. Our grandparents did them, and their grandparents, and theirs also, so we figure we should as well. We do these things because, well, we are Jewish, and that's just how it is. With such strong traditions guiding countless generations, it is no wonder that the Jewish identity today is based more upon our heritage, customs, being part of the Jewish community, and what we do, rather than upon our relationship with God. Many Jews I know do not understand that they can have a personal relationship with God. This is one of the reasons we are considered the least religious among all peoples, and that so many of us claim to not even believe God exists. For those who still believe He does exist, we are divided. To truly understand the Jewish culture today, you must realize that Judaism as a religion is not unified. Different expressions of Judaism are often in conflict with each other. Generally, the three main expressions of the Jewish religion are referred to as Reform Judaism, Conservative Judaism, and Orthodox Judaism. The Reform expression is the least religious, focusing primarily on social issues. Reform Jews believe much of the Torah is outdated and that each generation has the right to determine which laws are most relevant and essential to its age. Orthodox Jews take the opposite approach and are known for their strict adherence to Jewish law, both the Torah and the Jewish traditions passed along through rabbinic authorities. Meanwhile, conservative Jews straddle the line between the modernity of Reform Judaism and the tradition of Orthodox Judaism. They adhere to many of the Torah's laws, including keeping kosher, yet also allow for certain innovations, such as driving to synagogue on Shabbat. Within these three main streams of Judaism are other groups, all of which differ slightly in their beliefs and practices. Yet one thing that all three major expressions agree upon is that Jesus is not the Son of God or the Messiah. The Great Divide. Jesus. Ask any Jew what the difference is between Judaism and Christianity, and he will quickly point to Jesus. Simply put, one believes he is God and the other doesn't. One honors him as the long-awaited Messiah, God with us in flesh, while the other still awaits a promised Savior. Of course, the differences between Jews and Christians go beyond who we say Jesus is or was. Much of this book will delve into these other dividing issues, many of which have become the cultural elements Jews cling to as part of their Jewishness. But at the heart of true Jewish identity, Jesus is still a factor, for he is either the ultimate fulfillment or the ultimate fraud. It is ironic. Jesus was born as a Jew, lived as a Jew, died as a Jew, and was originally followed only by Jews. And yet for 2,000 years, Jews have distanced themselves from him more adamantly than any other group on earth. As we will look at in a later chapter, the man who shaped history lived entirely in a Jewish context and even stated that he was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Matthew chapter 15, verse 24. And yet, that house generally either despises him and refuses to call him one of their own, or begrudgingly refers to him as a good moral teacher who happened to be Jewish. Meanwhile, since Jesus' death, under a sign that read, King of the Jews, no less, billions of Gentiles have claimed this Jewish man as their Lord and Savior. Clearly, Jesus the Jew is a link, the link to be more precise, between Jews and Christians. He is the common denominator, and yet whether you see him as the problem or answer, as the distortion or fulfillment of God's word, is determined by on which side of the fence you stand. When you really think about it, however, why is there a fence in the first place? Why did Judaism and Christianity become separate if one originated entirely from the other? If Jews and Christians both believe in the same God, the one Lord and one God of the Shema, why is there such division? Why is history littered with deathly accounts of this division, from the early Jewish persecution of Christ followers to the Christian Crusades' mass slaughtering of Jews in the name of a Jewish Jesus? The division is still evident today. Recent surveys reveal that Jews in America feel the coldest toward evangelical Christians, even more than toward Muslims or atheists, despite evangelicals having been the most supportive group of Jews in recent years. Meanwhile, global anti-Semitism continues to rise. Studies prove that the number of reported incidents targeting Jews, vandalisms, bomb threats, instances of harassment, etc., has risen sharply throughout the world. Equally disconcerting is that many of these incidents have occurred in nations where the largest percentage of citizens call themselves Christian. Even though Christianity and Judaism come from the same place, twin religions birthed from the same womb, as some historians describe them, clearly there is a serious split between them, one that has existed for almost 2,000 years. But why? The fulfillment. Near the beginning of Jesus' most famous sermon, he made a profound statement that is imperative for both Christians and Jews to consider today. At the time, Jesus had kicked off his ministry with a bang. His powerful preaching, teaching, and healing were already beginning to draw massive crowds from miles and miles away, so much so that Matthew says, "His fame went throughout all Syria," chapter 4, verse 24. I imagine then that whispers and rumors were already starting to swirl. This man is not normal. He speaks with a higher authority, and he walks with supernatural power. Could it be possible? Could he be the promised one? One day, with the crowds still surrounding him, Jesus walked up to the top of a mountain, sat down, and began teaching his disciples, as any rabbi would do. In his Sermon on the Mount, Jesus told them about a heavenly kingdom where the merciful, pure in heart, and meek are actually considered blessed. He challenged his followers to consider themselves fortunate when they are persecuted, and he called these same people the salt and light of the world. These are often seen as the headlines from Jesus' message that day, but what he had to say next was maybe one of the most important statements he could have made, and it still resounds with great significance 2,000 years later. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish, but to fulfill. Matthew chapter 5, verse 17. Jesus had no need to make this statement at the time. No one seemed to be accusing him of throwing out the commandments of the Torah or any other parts of the Hebrew Bible. Yet not only did he know those accusations would come soon enough, but he also knew how crucial it was for all humanity to know that he fulfilled every command God gave his people. The world would be a different place if Jesus had not fulfilled, but instead done away with all that God had previously established. Ultimately, it would have made the Jewish people and their God-given laws irrelevant. Yet the Jews were God's chosen people, the very means through which he desired to bless the world and reveal himself to all nations. God had given the law and the prophets, meaning the entire Hebrew Bible, to the Jewish people as a standard by which they were to live, so that they would be a separated, consecrated, holy nation, a kingdom of priests unto him, a living symbol of his covenant to the world. Exodus chapter 19, verse 6. If Jesus had come to abolish the law, then it would render all that meaningless. But Christ did the opposite, which meant the Jewish identity was now ultimately found through him. He was the perfect Jew, the essence of what it meant to be Jewish. And by fulfilling every single command and prophecy, Jesus became the rightful head of this chosen people. This is why Jesus is called the Lion of Judah in the book of Revelation, and why that name will have such power through all eternity. In John's vision of a day to come, Jesus is the only one able to open the scroll that releases a time of both judgment and redemption for all creation. Yet it is fascinating that of all the titles Jesus is given at this pinnacle moment in history, as described in the book of Revelation, he is called the Lion of the tribe of Judah. And I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, "Who is worthy to open the scroll and to break its seals?" But no one in heaven or on earth or under the earth was able to open the scroll or to look at it. I began to weep loudly, because no one was found worthy to open and read the scroll or to look in it. Then one of the elders said to me, "Do not weep. Look, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has triumphed. He is able to open the scroll and to loose its seven seals." Revelation chapter 5, verses 2 through 5, emphasis added. The Lord will reign as the rightful king of the Jewish people and indeed over every tribe on earth. In Israel's history, the tribe of Judah was traditionally the royal tribe from which kings came. King David was from the line of Judah, and God promised that David shall never lack a man to sit on the throne of the house of Israel, and that he would establish his royal throne forever. Jeremiah chapter 33, verse 17, 2 Samuel chapter 7, verse 13. The tribe of Judah, therefore, carried a royal bloodline. It was the ultimate standard of Jewishness. It is not by chance that Jesus came from this same tribe and will be continually associated with it for all time. But why is he called the Lion of Judah? The tribe's ancient symbol of a lion dates back to when Jacob blessed his fourth son and called him a lion whose brothers shall praise him, and who will rule with a scepter that shall not depart until Shiloh comes, and to him will be the obedience of the people. Genesis chapter 49, verses 8 through 10. Jacob spoke these words almost 2,000 years before Jesus was born, which means his messianic blessing remained unfulfilled until Christ. Many of those who listened to Jesus' Sermon on the Mount would have been aware of this blessing, as well as countless other passages throughout the Hebrew Bible. So when Jesus said he came not to abolish the law or the prophets, but to fulfill them, he most certainly would have captured their attention. Matthew chapter 5, verse 17. He was pronouncing his absolute relevance to the Jewish people, their Bible, and their way of life. He was declaring himself the completion of Judaism itself, something Israel's religious leaders have passionately denied ever since. Yet, as we will examine throughout this book, Judaism is incomplete without Jesus. He is the ultimate fulfillment of everything it means to be Jewish, the law, the prophets, even the customs and traditions. Can you begin to see how tragic it is that the people who have historically rejected Jesus the most are the very people he represents? Jesus is not just the Christian Savior, he is the Lion of Judah, birthed from the royal bloodline of Jews. He is the Jews' Jew, to put it crudely, and he is returning to draw all people, Jews and Gentiles, to himself. John chapter 12, verse 32. New International Version. I have titled this book The Lion of Judah because in it we will examine how Jesus, as the Lion of Judah, is the aim of both the Hebrew Bible, what most believers call the Old Testament, and the New Testament. We will see how Jesus completes and fulfills the entire Bible for both Jews and Christians. Given that Jesus came to fulfill the Hebrew Bible, you would think the Jewish people would recognize all the different ways he completes their faith, and yet this is obviously not the case today or throughout history. Throughout the following chapters, you will better understand why Israel has not recognized Jesus as the Lion of Judah and its promised Messiah, and ultimately how this has caused such separation between Judaism and Christianity. My prayer is that you do not merely gain information from this book, though it contains much. No, my ultimate hope is that you receive greater revelation of who Jesus is and how magnificently he has fulfilled every word in the Bible, the law, the prophets, and more. The Lion of Judah is the rightful Lord and King of all people, Jews, Christians, Muslims, Buddhists, Sikhs, atheists, of all creation. As you see him from such a place of revelation, I pray that you can know him in a deeper way than ever before. May this book lead you closer to him. Chapter 1. Rediscovering Ancient Treasures. I was 20 years old when I saw Jesus for the first time. Having grown up in a tight-knit Jewish community, I cannot remember ever hearing his name mentioned during my upbringing. This made my encounter with him even more radical and profound. I saw him on a summer night in August 1978, when I suddenly awoke from my sleep in a state that I would describe as conscious awareness. I was aware that I was not sleeping and that something was going on. Even though I had never even thought about the concept of having a vision, this is exactly what I experienced. Jesus appeared to me in full color. I could see the terrain in which the cross he hung upon was staked. As this scene appeared to me, a ray of red light beamed down on Jesus' head from the sky straight above him. When I saw the light, I knew it was from God because it was piercing through the heavens. Although I knew nothing about Jesus, had never read the New Testament, and in fact had never even considered him, I knew in an instant that God was showing me that Jesus was the way to him. This was at a point in my life when I was lost and searching for meaning and identity. Yet in that moment, I knew God had revealed the answer to what I was seeking. That experience began a journey of following Jesus that continues to this day. It opened up a whole new world for me, as did the words of the Bible, which I began to devour as a new believer in Yeshua HaMashiach, Hebrew for Jesus the Messiah. Through the scriptures, I discovered that God was a personal God who wanted to be intimately involved with every aspect of my life, and that His Son, Yeshua, was living proof of His love for me. God was revealing more and more of Himself to me everywhere I turned. The year after I was saved, I remember visiting a church with a friend of mine where we joined a few hundred other believers to worship God. As a brand new Christian, I was eager to receive as much Bible teaching as I could, and when the preacher began his sermon, I hung on his every word. Yet what I heard that day did not line up with what I had been reading in the Bible. The preacher declared that God had done all He could, and because His work was finished through Jesus dying on the cross, it was now up to us to complete our salvation. The problem, the preacher passionately stated, was that mankind's free will was in the way and continued to thwart God's purposes. Indeed, the God this preacher portrayed was frustrated and impotent, as if He were up in the sky with His hands tied behind His back. God wanted to do something, but could not because people would not let Him. It seemed everything, including the outcome of the universe, was dependent on us. As I listened to this man, something rose up in me that strongly rejected his portrayal of a weak and frustrated God. After the service, I went with my friend to talk with the preacher, and I challenged him on his theology regarding God's sovereignty, pointing out passages of Scripture such as Romans chapter 9, which deals with God's sovereign election of people to bring about His divine purposes for salvation. Unfortunately, the response I received from the preacher was anything but open. Not long into our conversation, he turned to my friend and abruptly said of me, "This guy refuses to read his Bible." I was taken aback. After all, I was still only 21 years old and a new believer. Yet the Bible I read did not present such an incapacitated God. He was sovereign, which meant He ruled over all things, had control over all things, and was uncontained in His power. As I later began to think about why this man and I had such a different understanding of who God is, and in particular, how sovereign He is, I realized that the answer lay in my Jewish upbringing. In Judaism, God is Adon Olam, which means Master of the Universe. Although the Jewish culture I was raised in did not talk about Adon Olam as a personal God, I still grew up with an internal concept of God's limitless power. Even if I thought He was far away, God was still sovereign. This is because Judaism places a high emphasis on God's sovereignty and power, whereas in some Christian circles, humanity's free will is highlighted more. Often, Christians will base their entire belief system solely on New Testament principles without ever mining the truths of God found in the Old Testament. After that experience at the church, I began to recognize that when we as Christians are not rooted in the Old Testament as well as the New Testament, we can develop a distorted view of who God is. As was the case with this preacher, we can often neglect God's sovereignty, which extends throughout the entire Bible. In the book of Daniel, for example, King Nebuchadnezzar learned that his stubborn will could not ultimately prevail against an all-powerful God, and as he came to the end of his life, he declared that God does according to His will in the army of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth, and no one can stay His hand or say to Him, "What have you done?" Chapter 4, verse 35. God is not just sovereign. There are many other aspects of His nature revealed in the Old Testament. The Old Testament is God's self-revelation, as is the New Testament. They are not two separate books. The Bible is one progressive revelation of who God is. Unfortunately, many Christians today treat the Old and New Testaments as two completely different books, as if there were no link between them and as if one were completely irrelevant to the other. Nothing could be further from the truth. In fact, every book of the Tanakh, or what Gentile believers know as the Old Testament, is intricately linked to the Brit Hadashah, the New Testament. My prayer is that through this book, you will discover how the Old and New Testaments fit together like a hand and a glove. For example, it is not by chance that the very first verse of the New Testament begins by reaching back into Genesis of the Old Testament. Matthew chapter 1 verse 1 starts with, "The book of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham," and then draws a detailed family tree of Jesus that stretches back 42 generations. For most modern Christians, the meaning of this long list of begots is usually lost amid a stream of tongue-twisting names. For a Jew, however, anyone whose bloodline extends to patriarchs such as David, Jacob, Isaac, and Abraham warrants attention. For Jewish people, both today and thousands of years ago, heritage, whom you come from, means everything. So it is no fluke that the main common denominator between the Old and New Testaments, Jesus the Messiah, is immediately linked through his heritage to some of Jewish history's most important people. It is also not by chance that Jesus' genealogy connects him to each of the elements of the Tanakh, which is the Hebrew Bible. The Tanakh is made up of three parts: the Torah, written by Moses, Nevi'im, meaning prophets, and Ketuvim, writings, such as Psalms. Jesus specifically mentioned these three parts when he spoke of how he fulfilled all three. "These are the words which I spoke to you when I was still with you, that all things must be fulfilled which were written in the law of Moses, and in the prophets, and in the Psalms concerning me." Luke chapter 24, verse 44, emphasis added. In other words, Jesus was saying that the writings in all three sections of the Hebrew Bible point to him. When we view God's Word in this way, as one book written by the one true God, we can unveil the deeper revelations he desires for us to gain. Spiritual schizophrenia. The good news is that as we discover the timeless threads connecting the Old and New Testaments, our passion for God increases. The bad news, however, is that I see many people missing out on this today and instead reading the Bible with spiritual schizophrenia. They think God has split personality disorder and that he is different in the Old Testament than in the New Testament. Based on their distorted conclusion, the God of the Old Testament is a harsh lawgiver, full of anger and quick to judge, while the God of the New Testament is a loving Father who is so nice and merciful that he overlooks any sin. This distorted view of God feeds a distorted view of Scripture, which then feeds back into the first. When people see God as inconsistent and divided, it cannot help but affect how they see his Word. As a result, they view the Bible as split in the same way. Left of Matthew is all about law. Right of Malachi is all about grace. When divided this way, why would anyone ever want to read the Old Testament? We all would prefer grace rather than law, so why not just focus exclusively on the good news of the New Testament? Sadly, this is the slippery slope many believers are on today without truly seeing God's Word in its entirety or from a clear perspective. When we view the God of the Tanakh, Old Testament, as mean and judgmental, we will naturally lean more on the grace-filled truths of the Brit Hadashah, New Testament. Yet, when we do this, we unconsciously begin to give the Old Testament less weight than the New Testament. As the Old Testament's value decreases in our eyes, we spend less time in it and begin to think of it as far less relevant. And the more we do this, the more our perspective of God changes. We distort his supposed Old Testament facets, his holiness, justice, or wrath, for example, and opt to focus on his more desirable traits that do not challenge us as much. Eventually, we begin to believe, first subconsciously and then more overtly, that part of the Bible, the really Jewish part, does not apply to us anymore, that it is irrelevant. We become New Testament believers who live under the New Covenant and not the Old, and to us, that means we can ignore all the old stuff. This is not a new problem. Jesus apparently noticed people sliding on the same slippery slope and confronted the issue head-on in his most famous teaching, the Sermon on the Mount, found in Matthew chapters 5 through 7. Not to abolish, but to fulfill. Jesus' message to those tempted to diminish the Old Testament's value begins in Matthew chapter 5, verse 17, a verse I quoted earlier and one we will refer to often throughout this book. "Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish, but to fulfill." With thousands of Jews hanging on his every word, Jesus immediately established a fundamental truth that we must not miss. The Old Testament really matters. Everything Jesus did on earth was in accordance with the laws God gave Moses in the Torah. This was the standard of living for God's chosen people, to keep them distinct from all other nations and marked as consecrated for God. Because the Jews of Jesus' day still believed they were indeed God's covenant people, they still acknowledged this law to be God's requirement for them. Notice, however, that Jesus did not just highlight the Torah, the law, and leave out the rest of the Tanakh. By specifically referring to the law or the prophets, he was pointing to the entire Tanakh, all three parts. In fact, in Luke chapter 24, verse 44, Jesus specifically mentioned all three when he said, "These are the words which I spoke to you while I was still with you, that all things must be fulfilled which were written in the law of Moses and in the prophets and in the Psalms concerning me." By rejecting the notion that he intended to do away with God's requirements, the law, and his promises, the prophecies, Jesus both submitted himself to these standards and elevated the importance of the entire Old Testament. We must remember there was no New Testament in Jesus' time. His Bible was the Hebrew Bible, the Tanakh. And yet, what he said in the next few verses of Matthew chapter 5 directly addresses those who, in the generations to come, would argue that the Tanakh is less important or even irrelevant. When speaking of the Old Testament, Jesus said, "For truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not one dot or one mark will pass from the law until all be fulfilled. Whoever therefore breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do likewise shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does and teaches them shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I say to you that unless your righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you will in no way enter the kingdom of heaven." Matthew chapter 5, verses 18 through 20. Jesus not only held up the Old Testament and validated it by adhering to its standards, but also fulfilled those standards. He did not break any of the law's commandments, and he fulfilled every messianic prophecy found in the Nevi'im, prophets, and Ketuvim, writings, such as Psalms and Proverbs. Incredible. Of course, most Jewish people in Jesus' time did not believe he fulfilled everything in the Tanakh, and the vast majority of Jews have held this view ever since. But notice how Jesus, immediately after legitimizing the Hebrew Bible, focused on the connection between understanding it and greatness in God's kingdom. According to Jesus, those who know how to use the Tanakh and who teach its commandments will be called great in God's kingdom. And those who disregard the Hebrew Bible and lead people astray regarding the law will be considered the least in God's kingdom. Simply put, Jesus really valued the Old Testament and said we should too. Later in Matthew's account, Jesus conveyed this message from a different angle by using different word pictures around the central theme of finding a hidden treasure. At that point in his ministry, Jesus had begun to use parables to teach the crowd about his Father's kingdom. Even his own disciples were confused by these analogies, loaded with meaning. Yet Jesus affirmed them by saying, "It is given to you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven." Matthew chapter 13, verse 11. Stated another way, They were to search fervently to find God's truth in His words, just as a man would sell everything he owned to buy a field with treasure in it, verse 44, or a merchant would sell all he had for a single pearl he had discovered, verses 45 to 46. In case you were wondering, we are to do the same. When the disciples finally began to understand His message, Jesus gave them yet another analogy to make a crucial point. Therefore, every teacher of the law who has become a disciple in the kingdom of heaven is like the owner of a house who brings out of his storeroom new treasures as well as old. Matthew chapter 13, verse 52, New International Version. What law was Jesus referring to? The law of Moses, the Torah. In fact, I like how accurately the Tree of Life version of the Bible, translated by Jewish believers, puts it. Therefore, every Torah scholar discipled for the kingdom of heaven is like the master of a household who brings out of his treasure both new things and old. Tree of Life version. We who value the Torah, and indeed the whole Hebrew Bible, will find ancient treasures awaiting us the more we dig into it. The Hebrew Bible may be buried for some people, but it is not lost or forgotten. The more we search God's Word in its entirety, the more we discover the riches waiting to be found in both the Old Hebrew Bible and the New, New Testament. A New Commandment. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12 compares the Word of God to a double-edged sword, and I believe there are likewise two sharp sides to valuing the Hebrew Bible. If we go too far with either approach, taking things to the extreme, we can cause spiritual injury. One extreme is what we have already mentioned, living without any consideration of the Tanakh. When we neglect the value of the Hebrew Bible and think it matters little because we are New Covenant believers, we do exactly what Jesus warned us of in Matthew chapter 5 and are called the least in His kingdom, verse 19. Clearly, it is to our advantage to mine for the treasures found in the Tanakh. Yet on the other extreme is something I have also observed among Christians who go overboard in rediscovering the Jewish roots of their faith. In their zeal for honoring the Torah, they eventually return to living under the burden of the law. They become so obsessed with following the smallest letter of the law that they lose sight of Jesus, who fulfilled the law in their place. Jesus broke down all the legalism by summing up the entire law, including all the details of eating kosher and not breaking Shabbat and not being defiled, in a single command. Everything you would like men to do to you, do also to them, for this is the law and the prophets. Matthew chapter 7, verse 12, emphasis added. Not long after, He defined this as a new commandment to His disciples, even though it had been the underlying theme of the Mosaic law all along. A new commandment I give to you, He said, that you love one another even as I have loved you, that you also love one another. John chapter 13, verse 34. In fact, by following this new law of love, we would be marked as followers of the one who fulfills the law. By this, all men will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. Verse 35. Paul echoed the same new law in his letter to the Romans. He who loves another has fulfilled the law. For the commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not give false testimony, you shall not covet, and if there are any other commandments, are summed up in this saying, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Love works no evil to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfillment of the law. Romans chapter 13, verses 8 through 10. Love is the fulfillment of the law. We know that God is love, 1 John chapter 4, verse 7, and that He put this love on earthly display in the form of Jesus, who then laid down His life for us, 1 John chapter 3, verse 16. See also John chapter 3, verse 16. So therefore, Jesus is the fulfillment of the law. That is ultimately the heart of this book. My goal is to show how Jesus fulfills everything in the law and the prophets, and in doing so, is the completion of Judaism itself. But before we can delve into how Jesus fulfills Judaism, which is the solution, we must first address the problem. If Jesus did not come to abolish the law, but to fulfill it, Matthew chapter 5, verse 17, why then are Judaism and Christianity in fact two separate movements? If Jesus is the unifying element, the common denominator, and the fulfillment for both Jews and Christians, why have they become so separated? To begin answering these questions, let's first examine one of the core elements of Jesus as the fulfillment of both, namely, his Jewishness. Chapter 2: The Jewishness of Jesus. Can you imagine being in a Bible study with Jesus during his time on earth? I have heard many gifted Bible teachers in my life, but not one could come even remotely close to topping Jesus as a teacher of the Word. He is the Word, after all. Now imagine having Jesus as your Bible study teacher not just for learning about a single passage, chapter, or book of the Bible, but instead for all of Scripture. This was the case for two fortunate men on a 7-mile walk from Jerusalem to a town called Emmaus. The Bible reveals very little about these men. In fact, only one of them is named at all. We know Cleopas, the man specifically mentioned, was a disciple of Jesus, and that he and a fellow disciple were leaving Jerusalem and traveling to Emmaus after a whirlwind of events that had their heads spinning. Jesus, their rabbi, had been arrested during the night by Jewish authorities, crucified the next morning by Roman officials as though he were a murderer, and hurriedly buried in a nearby tomb. Everything had happened so quickly and unexpectedly that Cleopas and the other disciples were all left in a daze. These two men had no idea that Jesus had risen from the dead. They were unaware his tomb was empty. So it is completely understandable why they would never have expected Jesus to join them on their journey. He was supposed to be dead, after all. And yet, even when Jesus walked alongside them, they did not know it was him. Their heads were so foggy from confusion and distraught, and Yeshua was temporarily disguised. Scripture says, "Their eyes were kept from recognizing him." Luke chapter 24, verse 16. Luke chapter 24, verses 13 to 35 gives the amazing account of Jesus joining these two men on the road to Emmaus. But let me take some creative license in retelling the scene. Again, it began when neither disciple recognized his rabbi as he sauntered alongside them and essentially said, "Hey guys, what you talking about?" "You've got to be kidding me," Cleopas answered peevishly, maybe from a lack of sleep. "I know you're an out-of-towner and all, but seriously, have you had your head in the sand these days or what?" I imagine he later regretted saying that. Cleopas and the other disciple then began to unpack all the events that had transpired over the previous 4 days, informing the very one who had been the centerpiece of it all.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.